Go get Job 38. I hope that helps y'all. Go get Job 38. Job 38.
Job 38. That's good.
We're talking about resisting the spirit. God is smarter than me. Why am I going to sit up and try to argue with God? God's smarter than me. God tells us to give 10%. Why are we going to struggle with that? I don't know how am I going to do that? I need the whole 100. God want to just take 90. He want to take 10%. I can't live off the 90. Don't God know? See, you resist it. Don't God know? I just saw all the movements of the body right there. Don't God, I mean, we get all righteous with it. Don't God know that I got bills to pay? How am I going to live? I got a house note, a car note. God want 10%? That's what he said.
Amen.
So now what the problem is?
Amen.
What the problem is? That's what he said. So why you always got something to say? Why you always got something to say? Why you always got something to respond with? When God says, this is what I require. And listen, that's never about the money. It's about your obedience.
Amen.
It's never about the money. It's about your obedience. And God says, why you always got something to say? When I tell you something, you stubborn and you stiff-necked. It's just like those of us who are parents and we're raising our children up. And you tell your children to do something and they always got something to say. Yeah, we call them smart mouths.
Yes.
They were called smart mouth, and we called them sassy.
Amen.
They said, don't you sass me. Don't you sass me, girl. Don't you sass me, girl. I think it's interesting. We call them smart mouth and call them sassy, but we do that with God all the time.
Amen.
We're resisting, and we're wondering, Mother, how come we can't get no farther along in the things of God than we are? Okay, so now watch this now. Watch this. Job 38. Job 38, God wanted me to show us this tonight. Job 38, verse 1 to 4. Watch this, Dad spell. Verse 1. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, now it's in reference to Job and Job's friend. They were all talking about God and had all type of questions for God.
Yes.
Like they were putting him under a microscope. Had all type of questions for God. And God flips the script on them in chapter 38. Verse 1, then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, who is this that darkened counsel by words without knowledge? God's smarter than me. Gird up now thy loins like a man, for I will demand of thee, and answer thou me. Where was thou when I laid the foundations of the earth? Declare if thou hast understanding. And you can go on and keep reading all this. God get heavy with it, boy. In other words, they got all these questions for God. Every time God says something, they got all these questions. And God said, hold up, I'm not here to answer all your questions. I'm not here to do that. I'm not on trial here. I'm not on trial. You're not my judge. You're not my jury. Let me flip the script on you. Where was you when I created the foundations of the world? God is smarter than me. No matter how much I think I know, no matter how educated I am in the world system, God is smarter than me.
Amen.
That's why I don't need to be resisting the Holy Spirit.
Yes, sir. Amen.
New Living Translation says, then the Lord answered Job from the whirlwind, who is this that questions my wisdom with such ignorant words? Brace yourself like a man because I have some questions for you. And you must answer them. And then I love it. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth?
Yes, sir.
Tell me if you know so much. Yeah. Tell me if you know so much. You know more than me. I'm telling you don't do this. And you telling me why you still want to do this? I know more than you. I'm telling you stop that. And you telling me you can't stop that? I know more than you. I'm showing you how that's going to end up, and it's not going to end up good, and you keep going down that road anyway. I know more than you. I know more than you. And how better our lives will be, Sister T, when we realize God is smarter than me. Smarter than me. I don't know everything. What I know, and even that's a very little. I love what Pastor Brian shared with us when he came and preached and blessed us. He said, people with degrees need to understand that that's all you got is a degree. I got a degree in anthropology. The subject and field of anthropology is this big, and all you got is a degree.
That's right.
It's not putting down your education. It's not putting down your education. But we need to understand that's all it is. No matter what the degree is in, the subject is vast, and all we got, brother, is a degree. We walk around thinking we know more than God. You know, as a pastor, I can literally mess up the anointing of God that's on my life and the call of God to shepherd God's people. Because something about preachers, especially when you've been doing this for a long time, such as First Lady McGee and I, you will hear preachers say that quite often. I've been doing this a long time. I've been doing this a long time. Ministering to people, I've been doing this a long time. I know how to do church. See, that's your problem. That's your problem. You know how to do church. Didn't say anything about if you knew God.
Yeah,
I know how to do church. I know how to minister to folk. I know how to run a church. I know how to set a church up, move a church forward, buy a building. Yeah, I know how to do that. No. See, that's when you're about to mess up. And you fail to realize that God is working through you.
Yes.
And without God, you are nothing. You don't see that without God. You're nothing without God, and you can do nothing, my brother, without God. That's what Jesus said. He said, I'm the vine and you are the branches, and without me, you can do nothing. And all of a sudden now, because we've been flowing in something for a long period of time, I know how to do this. No, see, you need to realize, God, you're smarter than me.
Amen.
Lord, even though you've blessed us to come this far,
yes, sir.
We still don't know where you want to take us.
Yes.
So we got to humble ourselves. And Holy Spirit, we can't resist you. Holy Spirit, we can't strive against you. We're not going to walk in here like we know it all, like we know everything that's going on. God, we don't know. Got to submit to you and let the Holy Spirit lead. Come on, give the Lord a hand. Proverbs 3:5. We're talking about resisting the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God is smarter than us.
Yeah.
All of us should have shouted amen.
Amen.
I said all of us should have shouted amen.
Amen.
Okay, I'm still waiting for all of us should have shouted amen.
Amen.
There you go. God is smarter than us.
Yes, sir.
God is smarter than us. I love that story with Job. Job and his friends asking God all these questions. God said, I ain't going through that no more. I got a question for you. Where was you at when I created that yesterday? That's what I need to know. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. Proverbs 3, 5. Says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. Y'all see that? New Living Translation says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take.
Yes, sir.
He'll show you which path to take.
Thank you, Lord.
You don't want to resist the Holy Spirit. You don't want to resist the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You know, my son has been in the military close to 4 years now, and he's coming up to the end. And while we were there visiting with him, me and his mom, we asked him, we said, so son, what's your plans? What's your plans? He said, well, Dad, you know, I believe in God. We can get back home, and we want to be back there with you guys, the church, and we'd be around family. You know, Makila's family is there. You guys are there. I said, the church family is there. I said, that's a blessing, son. I said, so you looking at getting reassigned here? You talking about getting out? What you doing? He said, I'm talking about getting out, man. He said, I'm about ready to turn this thing loose. He said, I think the anointing has lifted off of this. And I said, okay. I said, well, whatever the Lord is saying to you, don't resist that.
Amen.
He said, exactly what I told him. I said, don't resist. I said, you flow with God. I said, and many times, listen, and this is what I told my son, and I believe this is applicable to all of us. Many times when God is telling you to do something, you have faith to do it right then. So when God is speaking to you about doing something, move on. move. See, because if you keep rationalizing this thing, again, not realizing God is smarter than you, and he put this up on you for a reason, and you keep rationalizing, and God already told you to do this, that, and the other, and you keep rationalizing this thing, and, right, okay, I know that's you, but if I do that, but how this gonna work? How this, see, that's what you're messing up at. No, when he puts something up on you, the fire for you to do it is right then. And many times when we keep procrastinating, we keep procrastinating and we pawn it off on, I'm waiting on God. When God done already told you what to do. Now it's just time for you to move. It's just time for you to move on. Move on that thing. So I told my son, I said, son, if that's what's up on you, son, I said, you got to do what's up on you. I said, it's up on you. You have to move with that thing. I said, what are you doing to put things in place? He said, well, I'm already looking for jobs. I said, that's good, son. I said, what you doing with your money? He said, well, I'm saving them. I said, that's good. So you want to start putting your money up? I said, you got about another year. We'll start saving your money. That way, when you get out, you believe God, you get a job. If it don't happen for you right away, you got enough money to live off of until the job manifests. So you got to put all your ducks in a row. You got to start thinking like this. But whatever you do, don't resist the Holy Spirit. If he's leading you this way, you go that way. And that don't make a lot of sense for a lot of folk. Yeah. Yeah, one of my uncles it didn't make sense for many years ago. My uncle was in the infantry unit, served 16 years in the United States Army, 16. And the Spirit of the Lord told him to get out. And my uncle wrestled with that. Yeah, he wrestled with that. Because in the natural, you don't do 16 years and you got four away from 20. You might as well just suck it up and do the other four. But don't you know if God told you to get out, those last four will be hell on wheels.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, and that's exactly what happened to my uncle. My uncle stayed in chasing that money because every time he reenlisted, they threw a check at him. Stayed in and chased that money and lost his family. Yeah. And my aunt got a divorce. And my first cousin is in jail to this day.
Wow.
His son is in jail. All because this man did not do what God told him to do. You too busy worried about what it's going to look like in society. If you fail to realize God's smarter than you. And so my uncle struggled with that. And it was sad for First Lady McGinn to see his downward spiral. All because this man did not obey God.
Yeah.
And my aunt kept telling him, it's going to be all right, honey. God's got us. God told you to go in. God's telling you to get out now. Yeah. And if he was with you when you was in, he'll be with you when you're out.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Can y'all handle a little bit more?
Yeah.
All right, real quickly. Three subtle ways we resist the Spirit. Come on, real quickly. Three subtle ways we resist the Spirit. Real quickly. I'm giving this to you because you said you can handle a little bit more. Three subtle ways. Real quick. Three subtle ways. Number one, by not obeying his word. By not obeying his word. This is the first way, real simple way we resist the Holy Spirit. By not obeying his word. I just gave you an example of that. By not obeying his word. This is the most common way we resist the Spirit of God. We simply don't do the things that he tells us to do, and we don't allow him to lead in our lives. We don't allow him to lead the way.
Amen.
I remember when I was evangelizing, I was on my way to a pastor's meeting, a gathering of pastors, my brother. And they were all there having a meeting, and one of my pastor friends told me to come up. He said, Johnny, I'm going to introduce you to these pastors. I had been in his church. He was blessed by the teaching and wanted to give me some exposure with some of his covenant brothers. And I was making my way from Killeen, Texas, on the way to Waco. I get halfway to Waco and my car engine blows out. Oil is all over the place. Car's on the road, I'm sitting there in a suit, and I'm like, man, what in the world is going on? I called a friend of mine, my friend came, picked me up, and I went on to the meeting. I went to the meeting, I'm meeting all these different pastors. At the end of that, now I gotta deal with this automobile. I come back home, I tell First Lady McGee what happened with the automobile, and the Spirit of the Lord begins to speak to me. And the Lord said, take the car back to the dealer, and he's going to give you another one. He's going to swap it out. But in my mind, I'm thinking, how in the world that going to happen? Because I got this car is all busted up with the engine, and how you going to just swap that out? I don't think it's going to work that way. See, don't resist the Holy Spirit. I don't think it's going to work that way. Well, fast forward, because I was disobedient to God, it cost me 8 months of walking. Didn't have enough money to buy another car. We were full-time evangelists. And it cost me 8 months of walking because I disobeyed God. God knew what I did not know. He knew that the person was going to swap the car out, and all I had to do was just keep paying what I was already paying. But because I didn't do it that way, I lost out on that deal altogether. And it cost me 8 months worth of walking. And I'm a full-time evangelist going from church to church. So a friend of mine loaned me his car. His name is Dennis. He's gone on to be with the Lord now. But Dennis was such a sweet brother. You remember Dennis was a sweet brother. He came and gave us his car. He said, Johnny, you can use my car. It was red and it had these gold old rims to it. And he said, but there's one problem with my car. I said, what is that? He said, you gotta shake it to find out how much gas is in it. Because his fuel needle was broken. And there was a little switch that you had to flip on to start the car. And I shook the car and I'm shaking the car. We flipping and we driving on our way to our next meeting. And we're thanking God for the blessing of God. Now, my friend was a blessing to me, but what got me in that situation? Yeah. The Holy Spirit spoke to me and told me what to do. Told me what to do. And I still didn't do it because back then I thought I knew more than God. And it cost me 8 months worth of walking. You better believe I ain't walking now. I learned my lesson. Amen. Praise the Lord. So by not obeying his word, write down Romans 8 verse 14. Romans 8 verse 14. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Number two, the second way we resist the Holy Spirit is by not heeding his warning. This is good. By not heeding his warning. By not heeding his warning. The first way is by not obeying his word. When he speaks something to us, the second way is by not heeding his warning. Remember, the Holy Spirit is a comforter and a compass. He will always guide you. The word heed means to notice, observe, and to give careful attention to something. To notice, observe, and to give careful attention to something. We must heed the warnings of the Holy Spirit. Write down for the sake of time, Acts chapter 20, verse 22 to 25. Acts chapter 20, verse 22 to 25, I'll read it. It says, and now behold, I go bound in the Spirit, this is Paul, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me or happen to me there. Listen, save or accept that the Holy Ghost witnesses in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. Y'all see that?
Yes,
sir. In other words, Paul says, I'm about to go bound in the Spirit, and I don't know what's going to happen to me except what the Holy Spirit told me.
Amen.
Holy Spirit told me, when I go down there, I'm going to be whipped, I'm going to be beat, I'm going to be afflicted, I'm going to be persecuted.
Yes.
But you know what? Even though the Holy Spirit told me that, none of those things move me. I'm going anyway.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, y'all got that? All right, but none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy in the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. Verse 25, and now behold, I know that you all among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God shall see my face no more. This is it. Paul is saying, this is it for me. Paul says, I'm about to go to Jerusalem, bound in the Holy Spirit. I don't know what's going to happen to me when I get there, except the Holy Spirit has warned me. And shown me this is what's going to happen. The Holy Spirit will warn you too. I said the Holy Spirit will warn you too. He'll warn you too if you submit to him instead of resisting him. He'll warn you. The Holy Spirit will keep you out of a whole lot of mess. The Holy Spirit will keep you out of a whole lot of mess.